And welcome to Ask the Expert. My name is Christopher and I'm your host. Today we're live streaming from the high-end show in Munich, Germany. And with me I have our head of the Dynaudio Academy, Roland Hoffmann,
Hi.
And our product manager for Hi-Fi products, Hi. Otto Jorgensen. Together with these two, we're going to talk about the topic sound beaming. But before we jump into that, I want to go back a year and talk about what we did the last time we were at the high-end show, because we went live there as well, talking about the Special 40. So, we're a year down the road, what has happened?
Yeah, that was our anniversary, so we had the Special 40 back then, a compact speaker, and now we make a big change, playing something completely different. But of course, in the background, this model we launched today was already in development.
In the making.
We were really busy while presenting the Special 40. Our engineers were really busy up in Denmark.
And I have to correct you because we're not launching it. We're previewing something rather
previewing.
Special, right? And yeah, as you said, we're a year down the road. We've been developing something new. And I think that one of the first questions we got when we opened up was from Udo Holzmann, who asked, will there be a new confidence? So can either of you maybe reveal a little bit?
Yes.
Yeah.
There will be a new confidence. Yeah. Is that reveal enough?
Yeah, that reveals enough.
Does that answer the question, Udo?
I was told to be short last time, so hopefully
yes,
that was short enough.
That was short enough, yes. Let's put that to the side a little bit. I know we're going to talk more about it. And then jump straight into the topic of today, which is sound beaming. And Roland, can you start by explaining to us, what is sound beaming?
Yeah, sound beaming is something that actually doesn't happen inside the speaker or inside the drive unit. Sound beaming is something that happens when the sound has left the speaker.
Mm.
So it's all about directivity. You know, a loudspeaker doesn't beam sound like a torchlight straight ahead of you. It spreads sound.
Mm.
So what you have when you listen to a loudspeaker in your chair is you hear a lot of direct sound from the speaker and a lot of sound from the ceiling, from the floor, and from the sides, reflections. And sound beaming is really improving that, how the loudspeaker behaves in the room. It's the best loudspeaker is worth nothing if it only behaves well in the laboratory. If it measures well, well done, but how does it really sound at your place at home or at Udo's place at home? How does it sound like? And that's really important, how the loudspeaker beams sound, and that is all about what happens when the sound leaves
and
the
I
drive
guess,
units.
And I guess that there's different ways of achieving that, right, Arthur?
Yeah, I mean, in the old Confidence series, we had a very distinctive feature with two tweeters. Mm. We have this symmetric array, and in the middle was these two tweeters that is part of the DDC system. That blends together with the way we did the crossover. With a very advanced, complicated crossover, we made that basically work, so you're steering the sound forward. You have less reflections from floor and ceiling. We still have full dispersion to the sides. You really want that to get the imaging right.
Yeah.
So, but we are steering the sound by controlling the tweeter arrangement together with the mid-ranges in the crossover.
Okay.
So.
And when you're doing something like this, I guess it's because we're trying to achieve something. So what is the advantage of having a sound beaming technology, just this DDC?
We're trying to achieve, and we achieve, that there's less sound directed to the ceiling and to the floor.
Mm.
I talked about these reflections that you have when you listen to the speakers. It's not only the speakers, it's the room you listen to as
yeah.
well. What you really want to hear is the recorded room. You want to hear, if you have a recording from the Carnegie Hall in New York, you want to hear the Carnegie Hall on
yeah.
that recording, and not so much your room. And if you want to have the Beatles in Abbey Road, you want to hear the Beatles in Abbey Road.
Yeah, you want to experience what was recorded,
exactly.
right?
Exactly. And the thing is, that's on the file, on the CD, or on the vinyl. It's on there. The room, the ambience of the recording session is on there. And that's what you want to hear. And the best speakers is not worth much if you don't have it performing well in the room. It can really smear the imaging and
yeah.
the staging, and you don't really hear, you don't really get the Abbey Road feeling.
And as you were talking about, it doesn't really matter if it's a good speaker, but only in the laboratory, right? It needs to work everywhere, and I guess that's where a sound beaming and DDC comes into place, right?
Yeah.
I think that's part of why the original Confidence was very popular, that it works in a lot of people's homes. We have a lot of positive feedback from the current Confidence, because regardless of the home, they get a good sound and like insight to the recording.
It takes the room a little bit out of the equation, so to speak, right?
Sure.
Yeah. So talking about sound beeping, and we've touched upon DDC, you were talking a little bit about what it is, but I was wondering if you could go into more detail with what DDC actually is, how it works.
When you have the two-tweeter arrangement we had before, you are kind of playing with the phase alignment between the drivers.
Okay.
You have a sort of the dispersion from the speaker. You have some lobing, as it's called. So right in front of it, you have a sound where you want it to be, but then you have a lobe where you have no sound. So if you control that correctly, you have the lobing right where you have the reflections towards the front ceiling, so that you will have more sound directly forward. This way of doing it is complicated and has some downsides, but it really works.
And that's because it's not only that we have two tweeters, but the fact that you have two tweeters means that you have to go in and play around with the passive crossover, right?
Yeah, so you have to, part of the DDC effect on the C4 and the C2 and the evidence has to do with the two tweeters, but also what you do in the crossover. But if you ask a crossover engineer, he wants to have the crossover as pure and simple as possible with the various components, but as a network as pure as possible, which slightly goes a little bit against the DDC, where you try to do something to the signal to acquire or have some sound beaming shaping with the two tweeters. So in the ideal world, you would leave the music signal alone in the crossover and have an acoustic shaping, beaming, right at the drive unit, and not so much in the signal. And that's what we do with this DDC and the new generation of DDC.
I think an important point is that we didn't want to really change the concept of DDC. We are working on improving the way we achieve that concept.
And we're talking about that the DDC, the current DDC, is something that we use in the confidence, but I guess we're also using it in other models, right?
Yeah, we have it in the evidence as well. We have evidence, temptation, platinum, master, that are very popular products in that category as well. So yeah, that's also very much true for them.
So now we've been looking at what we've had, where we're coming from, right? And I think that if we go back to Udo's original question, will there be a new confidence? You guys said yes. We've seen it here today. It's a preview, as I mentioned. What does the future of the DDC technology hold in the new confidence? What does it look like and where are we going with it?
I think we can show what it looks like, partly, because we don't have the full speaker here, but we have something that explains what we are doing, because we can actually visualize it.
Yeah, if you look at the tweeter front plate we have now for this tweeter, the way it's shaped, you can see that it's completely open to the sides. So on the side, there's no real waveguide effect. But we have this vertical arrangement where we are steering the sound first by these this tiny shape here, and then by the way it blends out from the tweeter. That really steers the way that the sound is reflected up and down, and that's not actually only in this faceplate.
Okay.
If you look at the actual baffle, this shape continues out into the baffle, and this part of the baffle is also part of DDC.
So it's DDC is now the entire baffle instead of just
that's right. The
tweeters?
It really spreads across the whole baffle.
Yeah, the DDC is actually also not only the tweeter, it's the complete arrangement is the DDC. We call this the DDC lens, this very particular shape from the tweeter and into the baffle.
Okay.
That's the tweeter part of it, you could say. And the most interesting thing about it is that now there is only one tweeter. So basically those lobing effect we had before by using two tweeters, and we used that very effectively. Instead of having those lobing effects, we are now steering the sound in the waveguide, which part of that we can do this is also a much more powerful tweeter.
Okay.
So we actually have the same dynamic range as we had before.
And I was actually wanting to ask about, so there's only one tweeter in this faceplate, right? So going from two to one, that's a big step, right?
Yes, it is. It gives some advantages. And the big task was not to go from 2 to 1. Of course, there's a lot of speakers out there with one tweeter.
Yeah.
So that's not really the challenge. The challenge is to still have the effects of steering the sound forward and still having it open to the sides. So even steering the sound in some way has been done before in waveguides, but doing it so that it actually works in this way without side effects, that's the main issue. And that's where Jupiter came in, our measurement room.
Yeah.
This is really done by heavy use of Jupiter and the simulations and testing that we can do. That's the only way we were able to do this effectively.
And I know, Roland, you've been talking about, you know, how Jupiter and a big team of engineers actually came together to move the DDC technology into a new era, so to speak, right?
Yeah, we have really good engineers, but if you don't have the room to try all the things, you know, the engineers are full of good ideas, but they really need the room, the measurement system, and also, yeah, the ability to play with all these ideas.
Definitely.
Without that, without the room, without these engineers, we wouldn't have this lens. It's not a shape that you just come up with and take a pencil and you draw this shape. We have countless models or shapes of this lens, which didn't work.
Yeah.
Maybe they worked in some areas, and maybe they measured even good, but sound-wise, it doesn't work out, or the other way around. So it sounds okay, but something in the measurement doesn't really work.
And I remember
we do that in Jupiter.
And I remember having seen, you know, a lot of different models of this DDC lens, right? Formed in clay and stuff, right?
And you would think it's everything about measurement and having the biggest measurement room in Europe and so on that solves it. No, we still have a lot of clay models, as you say, to try out things first, to measure things. So it's really the combination out of almost old-fashioned acoustic work together with high-tech measurement.
I think you also have to have some fantasy involved in how could we do this? I mean, measurement and simulations, that doesn't help if you don't know what to simulate on, what to measure on.
Yeah.
So you have to first find out, okay, maybe if I cut it like this, measure it, what happens? Oh, it didn't work. Okay, maybe if I do like this, maybe that works better. And then what do we do with that information afterwards? That's really the challenging part. And that's why Jupiter helps, because instead of doing a measurement and 2 days later you have the result, we can try something out, do the measurements in a few minutes, and then start working on improving it. That really changes how we
approach. One great quote from one of our engineers, and we have all these simulations, really high-tech simulations, but he said, okay, but sometimes our experience is quicker than all the simulations.
Yeah.
So we really have to have both. You have the ability to measure all these things, but sometimes you just need someone who has a bright idea, experience, and then I think if we do this, then it should work out well. Mm. And then you have the ability to measure that. So it really comes together. But not one way or the other.
Definitely. I want to go back to the shape a little bit, because in the start you were talking about that what you were trying to achieve was steering the sound in, you know, the height, not the width of the room. And with the DDC lens, there's obviously the height control here, but to me at least, it seems like we managed not to play around with the width of the room.
You know, the way hearing works, we are our ears are placed on each side of our heads, so we are very sensitive to information that's coming on the horizontal plane, and we are really relying on that for placement of a sound that we're hearing. And when you have two speakers playing, that is creating a virtual sound image where we are trying to pinpoint something in between the speakers or even outside the speakers. We really need the reflections from the sidewalls to make that work. Otherwise, our brain won't really interpret it the way it's supposed to be. On the other hand, the vertical reflections, that is just noise. That confuses the brain. It makes it more difficult to place stuff in the right positions. So that's why you want the side reflections to some degree, but you don't want the floor and ceiling reflections. That's why when that comes together, it really helps the brain interpret what we're hearing.
Yeah.
The brain is a very important part of hearing. It's not just the physical waves.
And also these reflections from the ceiling, they have a very short time delay from the direct sound.
Okay.
And our brain, it's not about our ear, but our brain is actually too slow to separate that. You cannot really, in most rooms, in a church you can. In a church you can easily hear, okay, that's a very high ceiling. It's very
yeah.
In a living room, our brain cannot do that.
Okay.
Our brain will mix up the direct sound with the reflected sound from the ceiling. It's such a short time delay that our brain, our hearing ability, thinks, oh, that's one information. But then you end up with a very blurred image of the recording between the speakers, because our brain thinks, oh, it's one information, but it's not. And DDC and the lens helps to have less of these reflections in the first place. So you don't have to damp the ceiling, you don't have to have any cushions on the ceiling. You actually have a speaker which directs less sound to that ceiling, so you have purer, more pure sound information coming from that speaker itself.
And in this whole setup, so it's a baffle, it's a faceplate here. Does the tweeter still play a role in creating the DDC to the or I can see when I sat still that you looked I feel like it's never had a big role.
No, I was just going to say yes and no. You know, the soft dome itself, which has been evolved over 40 years and you know, is very famous for what it is. That is, of course, that's where the sound radiates from. So if we change anything about this dome, this whole waveguide system would have to change as well.
Okay.
This is designed specifically for this dome and specifically for this speaker to work specifically for those mid-range drivers. So the whole thing comes together. So if we change one thing, we would have to change all the other things as well. So it's all part of
back a bigger
picture.
Back to Jupiter
then. Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Guys, I think that we can talk about the new DDC lens for
a
very long time. But I know, Roland, you have a sound demo coming up. So
yeah.
I think that
we are demoing the confidence every hour. Yeah. So and that's really exciting to prove what we are saying, that DDC really gives you this imaging and staging. So that's what we're going to do in the sound demo.
Perfect. And I want to thank both of you for taking time out of your day here at the event. I know that you have a lot to do. To come and speak with me and share some insights with our audience. And thanks.
Thanks
Welcome.
For watching.
Yeah.
Thank you.
And if you are in Munich, if you are at the high-end show, come by our showroom. Roland is demoing the speakers every hour. So come and take a listen. Thank you for watching and thank you for your questions.